Hi, I'm Rob, and welcome to the Uncut Network. Every month we rotate between directors, actors, and super specific genres, and we cover everything from exploitation to things your parents will absolutely approve of, relative unknowns to household names, and everything in between. The Uncut Network is the movie podcast of all of the niches, and to cover all of those things and more, I'm joined by Graham. Hello there.
Hello.
Clotilde. And Aidan.
Hello there.
And how we are doing this unreasonably early recording time. It's not dark out, this is weird. We all doing okay?
Yes. No. Great, yeah.
From that description, I put like exploitation horror, things your parents will absolutely approve of. And I think this week it's your parents will absolutely approve of it sort of category, because we're in it actors month. And it's Gregory Peck. So, let's start with Clotilde. What's our feelings on Gregory Peck as an actor, as a legend, I guess you'd call him?
Yeah, this is really funny that you introduced it like that, because my first sort of introduction to Gregory Peck was that my mom is a big fan. Like, I think she's Gregory Peck's bigger fan. Like, she loves him, so... that was sort of like my first introduction, is like my mom kind of showing me half of the movies he was in. Whenever he's in a movie, my mom is just like, we have to watch it, it's on TV. But other than that, I do think he's, you know, like you said, legendary. Like, I feel like it's that kind of sort of American actor of that time, that it's very hard to find people like that today, if that makes sense. Like, we don't really have that phenomenon anymore. And Gregory Peck is just one of the greatest, so yeah, I'm excited to talk about him.
Aidan, yourself.
Okay, let me take you back. Let me take you back, Rob, because this goes back to GCSE English classes, unfortunately for me, which is very romanticised, but even then, I just have to. Because my first introduction to Gregory Peck was one of the films we're going to talk about today, was To Kill a Mockingbird, and because... Whenever he comes up in discussion, that film is guaranteed to come up in discussion, because I ended up having to study that film and the book that it's based on, like from head to toe, basically, for my GCSE English class. And that's how I first became aware of him, really, through that film, and it helped me explore different aspects of his career, whether that be like some of the films we're talking about today or others like Cape Fear, Yellow Sky, etc., etc. The list is like endless, really, for what he managed to achieve as an old school American actor.
Graham, Gregory Peck.
Right, I'm gonna let the side down at the end then. My main association with Gregory Peck is I kept confusing him with Gary Cooper for like the longest time. I think, as with most things golden age Hollywood, I ended up working it out in Western terms. If I remember that Gary Cooper is High Noon, Gregory Peck is Jewel in the Sun, that's fine, I've got that clear. But sometimes these podcasts are not just an opportunity for me to talk about someone I'm a huge fan of. Sometimes they have an educational opportunity as well, and this is one of those.
I'm just a little more experienced with this type than you.
I grant you know infinitely more than I do, but in this case...
Do not complete this sentence with the usual female contradictions. You grant me I know more than you. But on the other hand, you know more than me. We must talk back.
Alex, what are you going to do?
Something more for you than for
Alex.
Me. I'm calling the police.
No, no, please.
You are giving me orders. My own pupil.
You don't know this man. You know only science. You know his mind, but you don't know his heart.
We are speaking of a schizophrenic and not a Valentine.
We're speaking of a man.
Oh, yes. Love. Look at you. Dr. Peterson, the promising psychoanalyst, is now all of a sudden a schoolgirl in love with an actor, nothing else.
Alex, let me tell you about him.
What is there for you to see? We both know that the mind of a woman in love is operating on the lowest level of the intellect. Doctor told me not to smoke in the morning, but I'm too excited.
The three movies that we're going to be doing today, Graham did suggest that one of them. And those three are 1945 Spellbound from Alfred Hitchcock, 1962's To Kill a Mockingbird by, I've minimised it too much, Robert Mulligan, and 1976's The Omen from Richard Superman Donner. So we'll start with them chronologically. Spellbound. Who wants to take a crack at the story for that one?
I'd forgotten we do plot synopses. This is terrifying. What am I going to say for this?
Get your pictures out ready, kids.
I can field it if you want.
Okay.
I'll lead by example. It's a movie about psychoanalysis, really. It stars Ingrid Bergman and Gregory Peck, a frankly too handsome pairing. They're just too beautiful. Let's get that out there straight away. And she is a doctor at a Vermont mental institution, and he comes in one day and he's the sort of the new head of the medical institution. But there's more to him than meets the eye, because he, as charming as he is, he takes Ingrid Bergman out for a picnic where she eats a thing that I've never heard of before. And sort of it's love at first meet, really, but there's more to him than meets the eye, because he doesn't seem to have any memory of what happened or who he is or anything, really. And from that, it's essentially sort of a psychoanalysis of who Gregory Peck is. Is he a murderer? Isn't he a murderer? And the interactions therein, I guess, simplest terms. So, Clotilde, feelings on Spellbound?
I really liked it. So it was my first time watching it. I watched it a couple of days ago for the podcast. And I feel like I enjoyed it more than I thought I would have. I don't know, I feel like the premise, like a movie in psychoanalysis, can go like either really boring or just like really cool. And I think it went like the kind of polar way for me. I thought it was very interesting, especially like from the moment he comes in, really, and from the moment you kind of understand or not understand what's going on with him and kind of try to figure that out. That's when it really got me. And I think it was a lot more interesting than I thought it was going to be. I think it's always a bit tricky with these films, especially because, like, you know, 90, what is it, 45? Like, sometimes it's hard to really get into those films because, like, the obvious special effects or whatever is not as up to date as the movies we watch today. So I think in that sense, it really did a good job of sort of keeping the attention going. And obviously, I think he's really good in it. I think it was, like, for me, at least another side of his acting career that I'd never seen before, or I guess another genre. I feel like I've seen him more in, like, sort of To Kill a Mockingbird stuff, if that makes sense.
Oh, yeah, of course. He's very magnetic in this. Mm. 1945 is a weird era for movies as well, because quite a few of them are quite literary, or, like, very stage-like. So, like, for audiences who grew up on more modern stuff, it is hard to watch these movies sometimes. But sometimes it isn't, sometimes it is.
I think there were particular types of delivery, aren't there, in older movies, particular sort of ways that actors perform that are often very stylized or stagey. I think that is present here, but it works very well, because this is both meant to be a sort of grand romance and also a story of the unconscious. And you think, well, what is it that knits those together? And I guess what knits them together is dreams. Mm. You know, it's a very swoony, romantic film, and it's also a very murky, psychoanalytic film. And I think you can sort of imagine a sort of grittier new Hollywood version of it in the 70s, but it would have to tilt towards one or the other. It would have to be either a romance or a kind of psychological suspense movie, whereas here we're at that point where it's very easy for movies to do both.
Yeah, I mean, just to bounce off on that point, yeah, it's like, this is not the kind of film you'd expect from 1945 at all, really, because usually when I come to think of 1945 is like film noir, but and it does have those elements, but as Graham was saying, there's a lot of sweeping romantic elements just by the opening overture, where it lasts about like 5 minutes, weird. And then it just like leads straight into the I was caught off guard a little bit by that because it lasts forever, that, but bless it.
It does, doesn't it?
You kind of got to...
Yeah. I think it counts. I've got the wrong movie. live theatre, live music thing. But I think it works really well because of the chemistry, really. That is a thing which is so present in movies of that era. Going back to what you were saying earlier, Clotilde, how they don't have like stars of this nature, and they don't have chemistry like this before. Well, nowadays, I should say. The only times when it does happen is when the actors are sort of already dating. And I don't know the history of these two people. Maybe they are at the time, I don't know. I'd certainly believe it if there were, but it's just the characters are very natural of one another. I think it's just, it makes the thing work, I think, really, that chemistry.
I think one interesting thing about the relationship, and of course we're talking about Hitchcock, whose history with women and whose history with actresses is patchy, but... This is a very young Gregory Peck, a very young and alarmingly skinny Gregory Peck, and he's in what you might call the subordinate role. He's the guy who is the object of desire for the movie's hero. He is the mystery who must be solved by the hero. You know, everything is done to him, and I think that's very interesting. I think it gives Bergman a great showcase as well, but it's interesting how much he is an object of desire rather than a sort of a lead, if you will.
It works for him, though, because I objectify any actor, but he is very handsome at this point in his career.
He really is. Yes.
I'm secure enough in my masculinity to say that. Absolutely. but it's the thing I want to draw attention to. Well, you talked about one of them as his treatment of women, but I'll loop around to that later. But the dream sequence, I love that sequence because Hitchcock's not a guy who's known for... I know he has Psycho, and Psycho is a marvel of editing, but he's not really well known for visual flourishes, and there's that entire sequence which is weird and surrealist. It's a wonderful little bit, really.
Yeah. Well, there's also that bit in Vertigo as well, isn't there? Very famously with James Stewart, like, just to colourise the, you know, the whole experience of it, just like him, like, travelling through, like, his own psychotic mind. But that's completely different, because one thing I noticed on the credits in relation to those dream sequences for Spellbound, Rob, Salvadore Dali's credited.
Really?
For handling those.
He is, yes. And if, like me, you're a fan of that era of painting and Dali in particular, it sticks out a mile in a good way. It is slightly odd that, you know, we get in our hero's mind and it turns out his mind is exactly the same as a Spaniard who is 20 years his senior. What are the chances of that happening? But it works because it is such a magnetic and flamboyant sequence, and I can't, even in terms of something like Unchained Andalou, which Dali co-directed, it's not really like this. This is like A-list, A-movie resources being poured in to make something that is very surreal and avant-garde, and it's hard to think of anything like it in the movies before.
We'll just go on to the other one then, the treatment of women. Hitchcock isn't known for being particularly feminist, we'll say. He was quite an old lech. Let's be a bit more accurate and say he's incredibly important, but he was an old perv. But let's be honest.
Yes, yeah, that's fair.
Yeah. And it sneaks through in the script. I don't know if anybody else noticed that, just the way the characters talk about women in this movie is kind of, it wears its age very prominently when it's any other character talking about Ingrid Bergman, like that scene in the hotel where the guy just turns up and thinks that, oh, he's a pretty young woman, I can lay on the what he thinks is charm pretty heavily, but oh, he's just a skeeve, isn't he? Utter horrible skeeve.
But, you know, equally, she's a professional woman. She solves the mystery. You know, she escapes certain death. She has, I think it uses her foreignness very interestingly, because you have to remember that the time this was made, psychoanalysis was a very new science. It had only been introduced to America in the wake of World War One, and so it's interesting that you have this kind of Scandinavian, I mean, Freud wasn't Scandinavian, but it's a bit closer to the birthplace of psychoanalysis than America is. You know, you have it coded as this very sophisticated continental thing that maybe isn't entirely American, but hey, neither was Hitchcock, you know.
Anything else? Clotilde, what was your feelings on its treatment of women characters? I hate to ask you only about that.
In a way, complicated. I feel like it's a bit nuanced for me. I think more so than like other Hitchcock films even. Or Hitchcock films that I've seen. Because there is this constant, she's constantly dismissed, even in her profession. There's a line towards the end where, I don't remember the character's name, that's great. But the old professor guy says, oh yeah, I always thought women would make great psychoanalysis until they fall in love. And it's like, yeah, right, of course he did. But it feels like she's constantly dismissed in her profession or as a woman, or just anything she says doesn't really count as much as her sort of male counterparts, especially in her job. But at the same time, I feel like that's not entirely a fault of the film. Like, that's pretty relatable now, even back then, even more, obviously.
Yeah.
And in psychoanalysis, it was probably there weren't many women in psychoanalysis at the time. So I think it's sort of this dual thing in a way that she's an amazing character, I think, in the sense that she's really driving the plot forward, and she's probably the one that, like, you look at in this film the most, even. Or maybe I did. But at the same time, this sort of constant kind of looking down on her, it feels enraging, but it also feels very real. Like, if it wasn't there, it probably would have felt like a fantasy movie or something. So I appreciate that was in it as well.
Yeah, it's very valid. I mean, I think that one of the lines at the end where he says, you're a very clever psychoanalyst but a stupid woman, and I thought, wow, okay, he's not sugarcoating it at all, is he?
Yeah
right.
No.
Yeah. How do you think it works as because it is a mystery? Do you think it works as a mystery because it is a very intentionally convoluted and messy sort of story and way to tell a story?
I kind of agree on that half, because I did feel a bit lost in the psychoanalysis of it all. I've got to be honest, like, I did feel a bit like on a heavy duty hand, really, on that regard. Saying that, like I say, it's Alfred Hitchcock, so I'll admit it's a handsomely made film. It's got a young Gregory Peck in, it's got a young Ingrid Bergman in, so you know what's not to love. I just think from this early stage on his career, I think there might be a little bit of a disconnect for appreciating it with modern audiences now, really, which is a bit of a sad thing.
Well, it's more awkward to analyse his later movies, I think, when he's in sort of the 60s and 70s there. It's the 70s, yeah. Especially his 70s movies quite awkward,
yeah.
I guess.
He's a man out of time by that point, unfortunately.
Yeah. Frenzy.
Yeah. When you think of Frenzy or Family Plot. Yeah,
it's Family Plot, the one films, with Bruce Dern. Am I remembering that right?
It is, yeah.
I think it is. It is.
So it's a podcast about Gregory Peck. So, I mean, Graham's pointed towards him a little bit and what he said, but what are our feelings on Gregory Peck in this? Secondary as he might be.
Like I say, I just think he's interestingly vulnerable. It's sort of when you spoke about how the mystery plotting is a bit sort of strange, a bit hard to get used to. Part of that is because we're in that era when it's thought that psychoanalysis is kind of like a jigsaw and everyone has the same sort of basic id, and if you dream about a fish, it means this and things like that. And so it does feel a bit mechanical. But on another level, it is about feelings. And I think you have to be a very particular type of 1940s male lead to do a mystery movie when the mystery is your emotions. Like, for a lot of male leads of this generation, the trick was to pretend you didn't have any.
Yeah, that was pretty much true until about, what, yesterday, I guess.
Yeah.
Clotilde and Aiden, then, what are your feelings on Gregory Peck in Spellbound?
I think that's a really good point, in the sense that he's not the male lead you kind of expect from this type of film. But he does so brilliantly. I think the only... It's not an issue, but the only thing is that I think I felt a lot more drawn to Ingrid Bergman. I don't know, maybe it's just her presence on screen. She's just so good. But he's, in terms of like supporting, he's fantastic in it. I just felt like she was kind of maybe the star of the film, if I had to pick one.
I do like the... I do like his boss as well, though. Sorry, just to get in there. Teacher, I guess he is. He's an interesting character.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, Aiden, sorry.
It's interesting that, because usually when you think of an Alfred Hitchcock film, it's usually the male lead takes the highlight. When you think of North by Northwest with Cary Grant, or like, say, Vertigo with James Stewart, here it's reversed, and there's a little bit of an
image. Birds is the only one where it's also a female lead. It's very rare in his work.
Yeah. And in that sense, it does work to the film's advantage the more I think about it, because, like I say, Gregory Peck, as much as he's great in this, it is pretty much Ingrid Bergman's film, I like it to think, because it's her that's like casting the strings and helping her get down to his, basically find out what his identity is in the wake of all this. So I think it does work in that light.
I mean, I like this. Definitely. I know that probably you dealt with horrible prejudice female actors in this time of Hollywood, but they just had the charisma that I think is missing in a lot of the generations that followed it. Like Veronica Lake, Ingrid Bergman, these were absolute legends of the stage. And I can't remember who was in it. His Girl Friday, who's opposite?
Rosalind.
She's another one of that era who's just very strong female leads that is kind of out of sync with that point in history, which I think is interesting.
Yeah, I think that I wish I could remember where I'm stealing this from. It might have been a review of Hitman, the Richard Linklater film, but someone said, people have spent so long saying we don't have movie stars anymore, when what the actual problem is, we don't have people who write movie star roles.
Yeah.
And I think that's so true. I think anyone in Hollywood now could do with a role as iconic as this.
Yeah. Either of them in His Girl Friday. I love that movie so much. I'm sorry. It's not relevant here. I'm just dropping it in. any final thoughts on Spellbound before we move on to the next movie? Anybody?
I just wanted to quickly shout out the Hitchcock cameo. Did anyone spot what it was?
I did not.
I didn't notice it.
No. He was leaving the elevator shortly after Ingrid Bergman goes down to see Gregory Peck in the office.
Well, good eye. Very, very good at.
Yes.
You have to. It is very much like Where's Wally whenever you watch an Alfred Hitchcock film, isn't it? It's just trying to spot him and wherever he goes in the cameo.
He sees it all over the place. Like, he's walking a dog in one movie and he's just sort of a random crowd member in another. It really is Where's Wally. That's such a good analogy.
It is, isn't it?
Moving to the second movie, which is a little bit, it's not an upbeat movie, I guess, is the sort of takeaway from this. But To Kill a Mockingbird, based on Harper Lee's very influential and important novel, who wants to take a crack at the synopsis for this? I want to point at Aiden, because he did say it was one of his favourite movies, so I want to put him on the pressure, put him on the spot by asking him. Yes, Aiden.
Yeah, Yeah, so To Kill a Mockingbird, as Rob said, based on the novel by Harper Lee. This is, well, it's kind of a, I like to think of it as like a childhood imagination drama, partly that, but we also get into like little complexities of it. It's set in a fictional Alabama town called Macomb County, and we follow these two young kids, one who's called Jean Lee's Scout Finch, who's played by, I think, Mary Badham is the actress's name. And then the other is Jem Finch. And it basically follows their childhood living in this, like, really poverty-stricken 1930s American town in the middle of Alabama. They live with their lawyer and father called Axe Finch, who is basically played by Gregory Peck himself. And the main gist of it, I like to think, is that you get pockets of side stories within this little town. So one moment, you know, the family's having to deal with a rabid dog, and the other moment, there's another side plot involving a character who lives next door to them, who's a complete recluse, named Boo Radley.
Young Robert Duvall.
And on top of that, but the... Yes. Yeah, wrong, young Robert Duvall, yes. I think that was his, like, what, his film debut. In a weird way, or his big screen debut, yeah. But the main centerpiece of this film is a court case that Atticus Finch must defend a black man who has been confronted and charged with raping a white woman. And of course, this is Southern America at the time, where there's a lot of white picket fences, as well as horrible, horrible racism embroiled with it in the same time. And that is the main centerpiece of the film. Basically, as well as the Harper Lee book.
So, Clotilde, what's your feelings on To Kill a Mockingbird?
I love it. I love it too. It's the first Gregory Peck film I've seen when I was like 8. Because again, my mom was obsessed with Gregory Peck and the film and the book, so naturally had to be the first one I watched. Mm. But I think it always feels to me like it's sort of the reference point in terms of like courtroom dramas. To me, it's always like that's where it kind of aims to go, the genre in general. And I think he's great in it, obviously, but his character is fascinating because it's really through the eyes of a child. So he feels very much like sort of this moral compass overall, like he's above everything. And he's, you know, whatever he says is obviously the best option there is. And I think that's such a fascinating way to kind of look at it because it makes a lot of sense when you think that it's through the eyes of a kid. And obviously her father is going to be the sort of person to look up to in terms of everything. And yeah, I really like it. I think it's so well done. And maybe it's also because, you know, I watched it as a kid and then I watched it also multiple times growing up. So there's a bit of nostalgia there, but it's just so good. I can't find a fault to it. But I really like it. I think it's also like, it speaks to the age that it's set in the US as well. And I think a lot of people would sort of not relate to that, but understand where it's coming from in terms of racial prejudices. And even today, a lot of it, unfortunately, is still very relevant. Mm.
Is it set in the era that it's made, sort of 1960s America, or is it set before that?
1930s America, it's set in. The book came out, I can't remember when the book came out, it must have been like...
I think it won the 61 like that, Pulitzer, but I don't know when it came out. I don't know how that works.
Yeah.
But
yeah. It was roughly that time.
Okay, either. That makes a lot of sense then, yeah. Graham, feelings on To Kill a Mockingbird?
Well, it's funny this. I watched this one first out of the three films just because that was the mood that I was in, but I do wish I'd watched them in the order we're discussing them because the jump in both filmmaking fashions and in Peck as an actor is remarkable at this point. He's not just the sort of dashing young ingenue we saw in Spellbound anymore. He's a father, he's an authority figure, he's the moral centre of the film, he's someone you look up to and admire to. I mean, you could see it in nascent form in Spellbound, but it's really come along here. And I think the film too is interesting in how it shows changes in Hollywood, even though this is still made under the Hays Code. It's still a style of Hollywood that is more artificial than what we would watch now. But the town feels real. You know, it feels like a real place. The kids feel like real kids. And I think Aidan and Clotilde are dead right at that child's eye viewpoint. is the thing that you have to take very seriously in this film. If you don't understand it as being like a child being initiated into the sort of horrors and the injustices of the world through their father figure, I do not think the story really works. But it's it's a remarkably different film in so many ways.
Yeah, and I think just on to that point, I think the vignettes around the main centerpiece are quite crucial to understanding it as well. Mm. Like I say, when Atticus has to deal with the rabid dog or anything dealing with Boo Radley, but they're not just left as like side content. It's there for a reason, basically, and it just helps build up with the central mantelpiece, really.
You can imagine that if Harper Lee published this novel today, some idiot would try and make a mini-series rather than a film out of this. They're like, well, we can't just drop the dog in there. We need to have the dog episode. But
yeah. That's so true, actually.
Yeah. But it does, it makes the world feel more real. It feels like there are 100 stories here that we're not privy to.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I do have one reservation about it. I do think it relates to the racists more than it relates to the people being victims of racism a little bit too much. It kind of robs them of agency a little bit. Which is troublesome. It's not like completely derailing the movie. Especially at the time, it would have been very, very hard. Because in 1960s America, was still not... Sidney Poitier is about it as far as like proud black American depictions on the big screen, so it's not like saying the movie's rubbish. It's just a victim of the time it was made in the sense of it would be very hard to depict these black people with any sort of agency, I guess, is what I'm getting at. If that's fair, I don't know. I'm getting lots of disapproving looks.
Yeah. Well,
no.
Let me just say, I think this is part of why I think the child's eye viewpoint is so important, because I think you can make that criticism, and you could, in a lot of ways, say that To Kill a Mockingbird in general is just a white savior story. You know, you've took American racism and made it into a story about one decent white man doing the right thing. But I think when you look at it through Scout and the other kids' eyes, it does make sense to look at it that way. Maybe I would have felt closer to you if it wasn't for Go Set a Watchman, which tried to complicate the figure of Atticus Finch.
Don't get me started on that fucking book. we don't talk about that.
It's kind of like a sequel, but like we won't ignore it. It doesn't exist, does it?
Yeah, she did do it like a late life second book. Yeah. Is that what that was?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I think we can all acknowledge it now, looking back on it, because that came out, I think, around 2014, 2015, yeah, so not that like long that. Ago.
Yeah.
But the thing is that it's acknowledged as a first draft adaptation of To Kill a Mockingbird, or first draft manuscript that it was pressurized into releasing. So I don't know how it got released, but at the same time, it's Jesus Christ, it does a lot of damage. Let's be real.
Yeah. It is a hard watch, though. I mean, any movie about racism is a hard watch, but especially when they're all so bloody repugnant, the characters that are the racist, the sort of the KKK style characters are just horrible to watch. But I think what gets you through constantly, it's the charisma of Gregory Peck. He's just so very, very charming. Well, stay with charming. He's very, very charming in this, I guess.
Mm. I wanted Gregory Peck to be my dad after watching this. the first time I watched it, I wanted him to be my dad, because he was just, I think it's everything you look in like a father figure in a weird way. Because, you know, he's compassionate, he's like clearly outspoken, can be very critical, but can never really even like raise his voice all that high or get incredibly like angry or shouty. And then, and you do see that level of restraint within Gregory Peck in this. And that's kind of how, you know, you've got to look at it in that way, in my point of view.
Mm.
Yeah, I do think one aspect of his character is a little left wanting, his explanation of the N-word. I don't think he does that particularly well, but He's explaining it to like under 10s. It's kind of hard to explain that thing to an 8-year-old. I mean, he does the best of what is available, really.
Yeah. And again, I think it's also because of it being like a 1930s thing. I don't think the politically correct term would have been used quite then as what we refer to it as now. Maybe, I don't know.
I think the other interesting thing about its portrayal of racism, I love the scene with Mr. Ewell outside the courtroom where, you know, he says that he doesn't mind that Atticus Finch is doing this, because obviously you don't believe that this guy's innocent. You're just doing it out of formality. And you can't quite tell whether that's what Ewell actually believes or whether he's doing that very sort of southern politeness with menaces thing. You know, is he trying to needle Finch to get him to say something that can be used against him? And I think for all, you know, maybe Harperley just did not have much insight into the lives of black Americans at that time. Most white Americans of that generation didn't, but she is very, very good at anatomizing how white people behave when the issue of race comes up.
Yeah, and to add on to that point, it's absolutely, I think one of the key points of this between Peck and, I think it's Ewell, the main racist guy's name, or something like that, Bob Ewell or something like that. You see that relationship like tilt and destroy one another in time, and it comes into full fruition when Atticus Finch absolutely demolishes the guy in court, which is just remarkable. I love it. Just everything I've wanted to do to a racist, just destroy them with rousing speeches. I love it.
Clotilda mentioned it earlier about it being sort of the standard bearer for courtroom dramas. That is a problematic genre for me because I just find them very, very boring.
Oh, they can be. But, I know. Yeah. But yeah. For me, at least, this one is like, there's like that twist that you really don't expect, and I do feel like you are on the edge of your seat, like waiting to see how this is gonna end, because there's a point where it does feel hopeless, and maybe that's when the courtroom drama really works, right? When you generally think there's no way out of this. But I agree, it's a very difficult genre, and there's only like a few that actually do it well for me, so.
I'd agree with that completely.
Yeah, I would agree. Yeah. I'd agree as well.
I remember, what was the, I can't remember the name of him now.
Are you going to say Mangrove for all the things about Mangrove?
No, Serial Mom. Serial Mom's a great movie.
Oh my God.
And then the last 25 minutes, it becomes a courtroom drama. It's like, well, what is this? It's either you know the person's guilty and you want to see him go down, or it's just sort of like treading water. There's very few where you actually genuinely care. And I think that's what makes this work, because you know he's innocent and you care that he gets away. So that's the hook that gets in there, I think.
I'll tell you what makes this work. It's just struck me, but normally courtroom dramas strike me as a genre where, you know, they're the opening pitch is something interesting has happened. But enough about that. Here's what happened after something interesting. Whereas in To Kill a Mockingbird, either a rape has occurred or nothing whatsoever has occurred. Neither of which I think are particularly edifying to see on screen. The more interesting question is, what is the truth and why do people believe what they want to believe? And that's why it works so well as a courtroom drama.
Yeah. The read the lines kind of approach, rather than obviously stating out loud what this is, basically. I think that's nailed it on the head, really.
And to add to that, it's also like, how is he going to argue it? Like, I think that's what's fascinating about it. It's not just, obviously everybody knows that, you know, he's right and he was innocent, but how are they going to make their way through that? How are they going to convince people? And I think that's what makes it fascinating, because it's not just about what the truth is. It's about how do you win? How do you convince people?
Yeah.
I got to spoil it a little bit here, but he's found guilty. And I've got to say, I don't really understand how this movie remains so hopeful, yet it's basically saying that institutional racism is inescapable. It's a formula that I can't quite figure out, but it does it. It's a rare occasion where it can be both incredibly bleak and incredibly hopeful at the same time.
Yeah. Mm. I think it goes back to the whole, like, kids thing and watching it through a child's eye. It's like, it is extremely sad, but maybe the hope is in the next generation. Like, he's not just defending an innocent black man. He's also kind of educating the people that will come after and hopefully will actually dismount this sort of institutional racism. And that's, I think that's where the hope is for me.
Hmm. Yeah, and give the African-American community the voice that they need at a time of, like, utter, demolition, yeah, basically, mm, as well. I think it also is providing them a voice as well.
Yeah. I don't think the civil rights movement would have kicked off by the 1930s, so it was definitely still in this era of segregation.
Yeah.
It's those important voices, I guess, for the next generation. Yeah. Any other thoughts on To Kill a Mockingbird before we move on to the next and final movie?
Just sort of one thing, just focusing on Peck, I think his reaction to Tom's death is just so good, because you can see there's still a bit of the sort of the man, a man trying to keep it together for his kids in him. It's not a full breakdown of emotion. We've talked about how emotional he can be with Spellbound, but this is very much a role where he has to keep it in check, and I think he manages to get across how overwhelming that despair is for him within that context.
Yeah, it's a very emotional moment as well, where the black community just say, "Your father's passing by," I think is the term they use, and they just all sort of stand up and don't say a word and just watch.
Yeah.
Again, it's one of those.
Yeah, as he leaves the courtroom. Yeah. Incredible.
Anything else before we call it a wrap with that one? Are we all?
I just want to give a shout. Yeah, I just want to quickly give a shout out to the guy who plays Tom Robinson. The guy, Brock Peters is his name. The guy who's basically put on trial for the crime. Well, the crime that we all know. Just he's incredible in this, Brock Peters as well, I think, and I don't think it'll not enough people mention his performance in light of this film as well.
Yeah, well, it was pivotal. Black roles are critically under-ignored. Well, they're ignored part of American culture, really. It's like, I can never remember his name. I'm not great with names, but the black actor from Night of the Living Dead was basically completely ignored until he died, really. So, yeah, there's a history. America doesn't really get better at this racism thing, apparently.
You wanted to see me?
So you're a private detective? I didn't know they existed except in books, or else they were greasy little men snooping around hotel corridors. Ah, you're a mess, aren't you?
I'm not very tall, either. Next time I'll come on stilts, wear a white tie and carry a tennis racket.
I doubt if even that would help. Now, this business of Dad's, think you can handle it for him?
It shouldn't be too tough.
Really? I would have thought a case like that took a little effort.
Not too much.
What will your first step be?
The usual one.
I didn't know there was a usual one.
Oh, sure there is. It comes complete with diagrams on page 47 of how to be a detective in 10 easy lessons, correspondence school textbook, and your father offered me a drink.
You must have read another one on how to be a comedian.
Hear what I said about the drink?
I'm quite serious, Mr. Marlow. My father's not...
Father...
Help yourself. Now, look, Mr. Marlow. My father's not well, and I want this case handled with the least possible worry to him.
That's just the way I was going to handle it.
I see. No professional secrets.
No.
I thought you wanted a drink.
I changed my mind.
Then what? How did you like Dad?
I liked him.
He liked Sean. Sean Regan. I suppose you'll know who he is.
Uh-huh.
You don't have to play poker with me, Mr. Marlow. Ed wants to find him, doesn't he?
Do you?
Of course I do. Wasn't right for him to go off like that. Broke Dad's heart, although he won't say much about it. Or did he?
Why don't you ask him?
You know, I don't see what there is to be cagey about, Mr. Marlow. And I don't like your manners.
Well, I'm not crazy about yours. I didn't ask to see you. I don't mind if you don't like my manners. I don't like them myself. They're pretty bad. I grieve over them long winter evenings, and I don't mind your ritzing me or drinking your lunch out of a bottle. But don't waste your time trying to cross-examine me.
People don't talk to me like that.
Oh.
You always think you can handle people like trained seals.
Uh-huh. I usually get away with it, too.
How nice for you.
Yes, what is it you're afraid of?
Dad didn't want to see you about Sean at all, did he?
Didn't he?
Could you find him if Dad wanted you to?
Maybe. When did he go?
About a month back. Just drove off one afternoon without saying a word. They found his car parked in some private garage.
They? Who's they?
Dad didn't tell you then.
Oh, yes, he told me about Regan, but that's not what he wants to see me about. That's what you've been trying to get me to say, isn't it?
I'm sure I don't care what you say, Mr. Marlowe.
I'm wasting your time. Goodbye, Mrs. Rutledge.
So, for an upcoming episode, we've got to pick who is going to be coming next, and we're on an actors episode, and to pair up with Gregory Peck, on recommendation of the people who've got with me today. It's not an actor that I considered, but we're going to go with it because it fits with that theme. Huge deal. Huge star between the 50s and, well, forever, really, in the case of this person. But Lauren Bacall, we're going to be doing her in an upcoming episode.
I mean, pure class, obviously, is the first thing you have to say.
I was just going to say, she was in an episode of Family Guy. That's the first thing that came up on IMDb when I just loaded it up. You said pure class and I just read Family Guy at the same time.
She elevated it by a bit, didn't she? Just by her presence.
The Sopranos, Scooby-Doo and the Goblin King.
She did some movies as well, I hear. Yes. I mean, the great thing about doing Lauren Bacall is that there were so many eras of her career and she was doing notable work in all of them. You know, you could have anything from The Big Sleep through to Jonathan Glazer's Birth and it would be completely valid as a Lauren Bacall film.
That is a fantastic thing, that. You know, like what you said there, Jonathan... what was it, Jonathan whose?
Glazer.
Jonathan Glazer's Birth. It just sounds like she was present as he was being born. You know, it's just such odd.
I mean, she might have been. She's been around long enough.
But yeah, the career that she's had, the classic film noir era, which is just sort of pick your poison, really. Dogville, she was in that, alongside Birth, that all sort of boom in the yes. early 90s. Yeah, it's just Hollywood royalty, really, isn't she?
Completely, yeah.
Which of course.
And I think, as Charlotte mentioned before we started recording, she did do the English dub for Howl's Moving Castle.
She's so good as the witch in that.
That would be the oddest triple bill, sort of classic film noir, 90s sort of weird, eccentric, dangerous sort of genre movie, and then Howl's Moving Castle. It might be the most diverse triple bill. Very to happen to have not Howl's Moving Castle and Jonathan Glazer's Birth. That is the oddest triple bill that we could potentially, you know, program. Which would be very impressive. Is there anything that either of you two have particular sort of fancies for within her filmography?
Written on the Wind, the Douglas Sirk film. I did a module during uni on Douglas Sirk films, the kind of melodrama, and she is extraordinary in that film, a true powerhouse.
I mean, all of those early noir films are just flawless to me, you know. I haven't seen Key Largo. I would love to see Key Largo, but I've never got around to that. But yeah, all of the... It's so predictable to reduce it to the Bogart films, and that's part of why I want to do this, because she had an incredible career as a leading actress and a character actress after Bogart, but those Bogart films are incredible.
They do have to be present in some way, shape or form, don't they? You can't overlook
totally,
that.
Totally, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, and I've not seen any of those, so that'll all be new to me.
Cool.
Looking forward to that, because we're not just a horror podcast. I'm on a list on Twitter that says horror podcasters. He's not listening to the podcast, whoever's put me in that. Clean. But has she been in any horror? I don't think she has. I think that would be a spot on her filmography.
Which is quite odd
for her career that lasted so long even. And there's no era where a lot of actors of their generation get called away to Italy to do weird little numbers for very little money.
Yeah, I suppose part of what's... She was always, like, a megastar in Hollywood, so maybe that doesn't exist. But I don't know, I bet there's something horror adjacent you could find if you dug deep enough.
Because the interesting part of these episodes is finding that real outlier. It might be Howl's Moving Castle, I don't know, but there's got to be a real deep outliner in there.
Yes.
And usually Robin has, like, at least six... she's great at finding these things, but you know, no, it is what it is.
This is completely true. Well, hang on. We are about to do, are we not, a horror film with Lauren Bacall in?
Well, yes, that is true.
Get on with it. Say what you have to say.
When the Jews return to Zion, and a comet rips the sky, the Holy Roman Empire rises, then you and I must die. From the eternal sea, he rises, creating armies on either shore, turning man against his brother, till man exists no more. The Book of Revelations predicted it all.
Well, I'm not here to listen to a sermon.
It is by means of a human personality entirely in his possession that Satan will wage his last formidable offense.
You said that my
Go
wife
to
was...
the town of Megiddo in the old city of Jezreel. There see the old man Buggenhagen. He alone can describe how the child must die.
Look here.
He will not be saved by the lamb, will be torn by the beast.
Will you stop? I'm here because you said my wife is in danger.
She is pregnant.
You're mistaken. That's nonsense.
He will not allow the child to be born. He will kill it while it slumbers in the womb.
What in God's name are you talking about?
Your son, Mr. Thorne. The son of the devil. He will kill the unborn child. Then he will kill your wife. And when he is certain to inherit all that is yours, then, Mr. Thorne, he will kill you.
That's enough.
And with your wealth and power, he will establish his counterfeit kingdom here on Earth, receiving his power directly from Satan.
You're insane.
He must die, Mr. Thorne!
You asked for 5 minutes, and you've got 5 minutes.
Go to the city of Megiddo. See Buggenhagen before it's too late.
Now, I've heard you. I want you to hear me. I never want to see you again.
You'll see me in hell, Mr. Thorne.
That brings us to the last movie of the Gregory Peck episode. 1976's The Omen, directed by the director of Superman, Richard Donner, who wanted to take a stab at the synopsis for this one. Knowing that this is a movie which has, I think there's four in the original series, there's a remake, and there's been a recent one called The First Omen, which is particularly good, I heard, but yeah, just this original. Who wants to synopsize that?
I can go for it. Gregory Peck and Lee Remick are a couple. He's an American ambassador. They've recently gone through a miscarriage. They adopt a kid of particularly interesting parentage, according to Patrick Troughton, and who could honestly doubt Patrick Troughton. The kid is the son of the devil, and strange and disturbing things start happening around him, and it's the Omen, and you sort of know what that is, right? I mean, part of the reason why I took the synopsis on for this is because everyone knows what happens in the Omen.
Yep. And failing to, closely followed by Jerry Goldsmith's Horror Me.
Yes.
Closely followed by that, yes. So, yeah.
Iconic.
Or the Latin chanting.
Clotilde, what's your feelings on The Omen?
So, I'm quite bad with horrors. That's, like, my thing. Like, I'm just bad with horror films because if they're really good, then I'm going to be really scared, so I'm not going to like it. Does it make sense? Like, it makes sense in my head. Right? Okay. But I did, as bad as I am with like horror films, I did enjoy The Omen, maybe because I watch it on my little TV, like screen in my room rather than in the cinema. I think that helped. But I think for me, what's always like fascinating is like the religious references. I always find that, I know it's like in a ton of horror films, but I always find it very fascinating, just to kind of like see how they reference the religious aspect, really, which is both visual, I think, in The Omen, but in The Omen is really kind of plot wise as well, I think, to me. Like at the beginning, like this whole idea of kind of adopting a child that's not your own, I find that to have like such a strong parallel with the Bible itself, or like just taking on this, I was about to say burden, it's not a burden, but like taking on this responsibility. So I found that really fascinating, how sort of it parallels narratively certain things from the Bible or religion. I always kind of love looking for those like religious references in horror films. And I think it really does kind of nail those, especially given obviously the subject matter, it kind of has to. But yeah, I thought that was particularly fascinating to me.
Yeah. You know, I should too, when I was forced to go to Sunday school, grew up in a Catholic family. But I've pretty much just got like a memory not present section in my memory from that era of my life.
But well, I grew up in a very Catholic country, so you know, I get it.
Aidan, feelings on The Omen?
First time I saw it, and I've got to be honest with you, I really liked it, to be perfectly honest. And it's interesting because, like, well, it depends on how I feel about horror movies like Catil. Sometimes I will watch them, like do a massive season of them. Sometimes I won't, depending on what mood I'm in. But like I say, it's nice to tick this off finally off my watch list, because I tell you one thing, it's very good at. It's just good at setting up this ambiguous tone to it initially, because I think what Richard Donner initially wanted this to be was like whether or not this is just a series of misfortunate accidents, or whether this kid is really literally the son of the devil. And I think by the time you work it out at the end, it is leaning towards that. But it's like very like gruesome, fun, satanistic, I guess. Yeah, there you go. No, I enjoyed it a lot.
The thing that gets me is, why did they pick those dogs? Those dogs are little bastards anyway, so you don't need a demon child to pick up legs. Yeah.
the Rottweilers.
They're more Jack Russells. If it was Jack Russells, I thought, yeah, you've done nothing. They're just little monsters.
The scene where Peck gets attacked by the Rottweilers in the graveyard, you just immediately think, oh my god, is Peck doing that for real there? Mm. Is he, yeah, you do wonder about like stunt standards in the 70s, yeah. Really. Helps him.
It's like you never set it up, but there's a movie from the 70s, I think it's the 70s, maybe 80s, it's really good, called White Dog, which is basically about a guy who's wrestling with a dog over and over again. Wow, that must have been a difficult movie to do, honestly. But for me, what stands out for me is its sense of doom. It's not a particularly hopeful movie at any point. It effectively feels like they're doomed from minute one, especially with some of the iconic scenes that like the first at the party where the woman jumps off the balconies. Is this is all for you, Damien?
Yes.
And from then, it just feels like, yeah, this is not a potentially... Because one of the things of horror movies is you got to feel like there's a chance that they'll get out the other end. That there's a chance that they'll survive. And that's where the suspense comes from. But here, it's like, nah, it's pretty... You're pretty damned.
No, I think, just to add on to that, I think the other reason why, because you do get a sense of it being like a death-led film, because everywhere they follow, like I say, there's a series of misfortune accidents, but that sense of doom just only heightens that memorability for me. So you'll do get a lot of like I say, everything's like heightened, the doom's heightened, you know, Peck's like, but Peck is still like incredibly subdued and mannered. And I think that just really takes it into advantage, the film. In all honesty.
Although he gets rattled well, doesn't he? You know, you see him in this film where he looks really shaken and you think, oh yeah, Atticus Finch never looked like that.
No. No, that's true.
The ice cream vans round your way of... they're like a hoop concert.
Yeah. I mean, the thing that you always forget about this is you kind of see Gregory Peck as the bad guy, because at the end of the day, the solution is he does want to murder a child brutally.
Yes, yeah.
And
his own adopted son, yeah.
And I think that's part of where the tension comes from. As you say, it's a very doom-laden film. It's a film which no one seems like they're going to get out of it okay. The tension is about who's going to be believed. Like, when you first see Patrick Troughton's character, the priest, he seems absolutely mad. He barges his way into Gregory Peck's office and starts ranting about his child having a jackal for a mother. And you sympathise utterly with Peck's decision to just get the guy taken out by security. But by the end of the film, Peck himself looks just as crazy as that.
Yeah. I love that first scene between Troughton and Peck. The second it's Doctor so versus good. Atticus Finch. It is very fun.
I mean, you forget that as well as being in Doctor Who, Patrick Troughton was also one of the regular repertory companies of Hammer films. So if you need someone to sell some absolute grade A satanic bollocks and just deliver it in a way that makes it sound like the most important thing on earth, who's better?
Going back to the Catholicism of it, I remember, well, my dad told me, I was surprised to hear this, that that whole sort of legacy of The Exorcist, where people were out, like nuns were outside like cinemas saying, "Down with this sick filth, ban this." That was real, and that still boggles my brain to this day how I've never even seen a nun these days, never mind I have like loads of outside of a cinema protesting about a movie. But honestly, rather than The Exorcist, I thought this would be the one that got them all out, because this is
The Exorcist is a weird target for that, because The Exorcist is one of the few Hollywood films where Catholic priests are the heroes.
Yeah, they absolutely are.
And
he's a stark. He's gone to the wind. He's totally lost his mind in this one. It's not.
Yeah.
And isn't it his idea to kill the kid?
I can't remember if it's between.
Oh no, wait, no, it is Patrick Troughton, isn't it? Or is it? I can't remember.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he does get a cool death scene, so you know it's.
That's fine.
He really does. Yeah.
Oh, can we talk about David Warner? I need to talk about David Warner, because I think...
With his hair like a freaky beatnik.
Because I honestly think, David Warner is fantastic as well. Equally as both Patrick Troughton, Lee Remick and Gregory Peck, as the photographer who initially gets Robert Thorne, that's the name of the character actor that Peck plays, into like the photography room and looks at all these weird premonitions, targets basically on the back of everyone who's been slaughtered, and all these photographs almost appearing as lightning bolts in the photographs themselves. I just think he does an excellent job at just explaining these things in that committed David Warner way. Yeah, I think it's great.
David Warner is just great in general. Is the good guys. But how about Peck in this? Clotilde, how do you think he carries this movie effectively?
I think he's really good. Well, again, it's like, I feel like all these films are something different in his performance. Like, they all have different elements. I think in this one, it's just, especially towards the end, you kind of really see him sort of being pushed over the edge. And that's, I think that's really fascinating to see, because I think we mentioned this, like, that's not something that I think any of his characters that of the films that we've analyzed would have done. And you can really see how he sort of embodies characters so differently. It's just, I think it's brilliant to see on screen.
Because he's just genuinely, I think he did a Moby Dick movie, and I imagine he's absolutely barmy as Captain Ahab, as you kind of have to be. But generally, he's just very smooth. He's a smooth operator. Gregory Peck, and it's nice to see something finally get under its skin.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think even in Spellbound, there's a kind of implicit promise, isn't there, that when he starts to get stressed out about him, you know, maybe I'm crazy, maybe I'm a killer, part of you thinks, no, you're not going to be that bad. They'd get, you know, Lionel Barrymore to play you if you were that bad. But yeah, in this one, you do believe it. And I think it's part of what comes with maybe being a bit aged out of the traditional matinee idol role, is that you can play these roles where they take on a bit more stress, where they might snap.
Yeah, very daring as well. In the nature of his snap, I mean.
Yes, definitely, yeah.
Any thoughts about the Omen before we talk about Peck in general? Anything we've not mentioned that you'd like to bring up? Anybody?
I think one thing that interested me is that part of the demarcation between like A movie horror and B movie horror in the 70s seems to be partly about age. You know, you look at the great sort of independent or low budget horror movies of that age, and of course there are some that are among the greatest of all time. This is the era that brought you Halloween and the Texas Chainsaw Massacre and all of these films, but they're about kids. You know, when you look at The Exorcist and The Shining and this, they're about adults having actual adult problems, and that seems to be more of a dividing line than, you know, budget or level of violence. That seems to be something that people kind of ignore when they talk about the difference. But, you know, the kids in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre are never going to cope with miscarriage. It's just not part of their world at this age.
No,
I think the fact that Peck and Remick are both a little older means you do buy them as people who've gone through some stressful times.
Make a good companion piece with the Changeling, actually. I never remember who did
that's
that.
That's a good shout. Yeah, that's a really good shout, the George T. Scott film. Yeah, I remember seeing that a few years ago, and yeah, you're absolutely right, that would make a great double bill.
They're both powerful, I hate to say it, but both powerful white men having just a really bad day.
There's
a kind of joy in that, really. As a very unpowerful, very not powerful at all white man. So before we talk about legacy, he's got such a vast career. I'll stay with Clotilde for this. Any other movies from his filmography that stand out from you? Any that you're particularly fond of?
There's one I don't remember titles. I think it's Gentleman's Agreement. Does that sound like it could be a title? Yeah, right? Let me check that really quickly. I feel like it's a bit of a kind of problematic film, maybe a bit now, but it's I just think he's great in it. I really like it. I really like his performance. I think the film has its issues, especially when watching like 2024, but I think his performance is great. And again, it's a sort of other iteration, I guess, of his acting that I didn't really see in many other films of his career.
That's his romantic lead era, isn't it? Sort of,
yeah.
Early 40s. Yeah. It's a pity we never found his place or something like that. It'd have been interesting to see him as a more traditional, straight-laced, romantic guy rather than the forgetful one. Yeah. Aidan, any others that stand out from his filmography?
Like I say, when we discuss Robert Mitchum, I'll always bang the drum for Cape Fear, because, yeah, Cape Fear is a fantastic film, and he's equally great pitched against Robert Mitchum, who's, like, the canonical villain in that film, against, as we were saying before, Peck's, like, smooth talker, no-nonsense, Atticus Finch-like attitude. I think it's a great one to discover for that. Outside of that, there is... I've only just looked at my letterbox right now, and I've only seen like a couple of like Peck films, less than I should have, in performance-wise, because there's films that I would love to see, like The Gunfighter or Roman Holiday. But the only of the two that I have seen, personally, is Yellow Sky, which is one of his Western roles. So think
I think it was like 40s, I want to say, where he was more into those.
He was very prolific like in the 40s. Era, yeah.
How the West was won. Yeah. And the other one is The Boys from Brazil, where he plays Joseph Bengler.
Oh, yeah, that's a bit of a turnaround from Atticus Finch, isn't it?
Yeah, and honestly, if you want to see a performance in the total opposite way, where you want to see him chew the scenery a bit, I think that's a good one. Because honestly, no furniture goes like unslobbered in that because of his performance. I don't think it's a great film, but it's very watchable. I will say that.
He goes full Hopkins, does he? Yeah.
Yeah, he goes full Hopkins in that one. It's an interesting one. Like I say, I don't think it's a great film because it is deeply problematic in terms of how it represents, like, obviously, like World War II and like the Holocaust and things like that. Yeah. But just to watch it, it's a fascinating one, I think.
Yeah, that's sort of a concern, really, isn't it, when you watch old movies? Do you watch them with eyes of a modern viewer, or do you try and sort of relate to what it was like to watch it at the time? It's easy with some movies than it is with others, but it's something you should try to do, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a tricky balance as well, I think, because it's like
something really, really bad you can't, but yeah, it's a tricky balance, absolutely. Yeah. And Graham, any others from his filmography that particularly stand out for you that you'd like to highlight?
I mean, well, I'm the novice here, so, you know, I can only say what I'm looking forward to exploring. And I think Moby Dick, which we mentioned, I'd love to see because I'm a huge fan of the novel. I would like to see Roman Holiday, which is like one of those canonical romantic comedies where everyone who sets out to write a romantic comedy has to look at that as one of the benchmarks. And I'd like to watch all of his westerns. I was very cautious, partly wanted to suggest Jewel in the Sun for this, but I think doing this podcast has made Rob hit his western quota for the year pretty early, and I don't want to push him much further than that. But yes, all of those look great.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a quite hopeful way to look at it as well, with a filmography like this, looking at what you haven't seen. I mean, I would like to see Roman Holiday too. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, you talk about romantic comedies now, and it's become kind of a dirty word almost. It's clawing itself back a bit with, like, in recent years. There's been some really good ones. Rye Lane, which I've mentioned before, I absolutely loved that movie. That was great. But
yeah,
for a good few decades, it was just awful. And there's movies like Roman Holiday, The Apartment, which are just these, I guess, A New Leaf, which is one which people don't really talk about that much. Elaine May, I think, did that.
Yeah.
That's a wonderful, that's wonderful a movie. Film. But yeah, I would put Roman Holiday in that sort of group of just, it's okay for men to like romantic comedies. It's not a dirty word. Yes.
No. You do you, man. I agree. Yeah.
Well, I've got a pink t-shirt and pink shoes as well. I don't care what anybody thinks of me. Screw the lot of them. Clotilde, feelings on the, like, well, the legacy of Gregory Peck. What do you think it is at this point in time?
It's a good question. I think, like I said, there's just no one doing it like him, is there? And there's, you know, multiple factors to it. There's obviously the industry has changed so much, and especially for actors, like the studio system was completely different. How like actors and contracts and everything worked. It's a different world. But I do feel like nobody has that quite that kind of star power, but also that sort of appeal in a way. Like, he's very transformative. Like we said, he can do like very different roles, but at the same time, he always has in a way that appeal to him. I feel like in that sense, he's quite reliable. And I think now it's hard to find somebody like that. I don't know, maybe in the future soon, I hope.
Well, I mean, of his generation, though, like, all of his peers were always involved in some sort of problem or in trouble or a bit of a bad boy. Mm-hmm. He was just a nice, reliable
guy. That's
a good
point. Yeah. And I think people liked that about him, or like maybe audiences at the time as well. It was like a thing. that drew people to him.
It gave him longevity.
I think it...
Yeah,
it makes him more credible in certain roles. We've talked about Robert Mitchum a lot. I love Robert Mitchum. He might be my favourite movie star. But you could not cast Robert Mitchum as Atticus Finch. People would not stand for it at all.
1960s. No, you wouldn't.
No.
Yeah, but he was a nice guy, Laura Mitchum. He was absolutely a nice guy. But he just didn't project it on screen.
No.
Anything. Coming to think about it now, it would make an interesting double bill watching To Kill a Mockingbird and The Night of the Hunter back-to-back. It's a weird double bill, yeah. Could work that way. Two sides of a distinct coin, I like to think.
Tip kind of child's eye view of the crime movie, yeah.
Aidan, your thoughts on his legacy as a movie star?
Yeah, just to pass on with what you just said there, Rob, about how Gregory Peck never really got involved in that bad boy lifestyle, because like I said, it just goes back to the reliable, lovable movie star persona that he had. And as Catil says, you don't really get to see that this day and age, where you know, in the era of like social media and things like that. So I just love the guy. I honestly think out of that cohort of like 60s American actors or 50s American actors, like James Stewart, like James Cagney or Cary Grant, anyone like that, I think Peck is my favourite actor from that era, because he was just so suave and so smooth, but also just really lovable and likeable as a screen persona.
Yeah, I mean, look at the ones that we have from that era, like Richard Harris, Oliver, oh, I forgot his name now. The drunk
Oliver
one.
Reed.
Oh, the drunk Reed. One, yeah, Oliver Reed.
They're all the drunk one.
It's not a great era for British actors, really. But yeah, he really stood above. Graham, your thoughts on Peck's legacy?
Like I say, just getting started. I will say that I've just, while I was browsing around looking at the rest of his career, his role in the Omen as the US ambassador was pretty apt, because had the Democrats won re-election in 1968, Lyndon Johnson wanted to make Gregory Peck the US ambassador to Ireland.
Really?
Oh dear.
Yeah, just throwing that in there. Yeah.
Wow.
Nice bit of trivia to end on. So coming up in the next episode, we're keeping it with classic long tenured actors, with Lauren Bacall. So
yes.
What's our feeling? Have we got any feelings on Lauren Bacall as a group?
I'm a bit of a novice when it comes to Bacall, sadly. I really should actually get into more of a filmography, but I don't think I've actually seen that many of her performances.
You'd be surprised. She's that...
Yeah.
Had such a long career. You've probably seen something from her without realising you've seen something with her in it. She's that sort of actor.
Oh, I've seen Written on the Wind, the Douglas Sirk film. She's in that. She was good in that. And she also lived into her career into the 21st century as well, because she did pop up in a few odd pockets of films as well, which is really cool.
Yeah, this is what I wanted to say about Lauren Bacall. Like, obviously, the early noir stuff like The Big Sleep is rightly iconic, but I think it changes your relationship to a classic Hollywood star when, you know, you've been to the cinema and seen a new film that they were in, which I have done. You know, she's the woman who was there at the inception of film noir, and she also stayed acting long enough to do a guest role in The Sopranos. That's staying power.
Absolutely. Clotilde, any Bacall thoughts before we wrap up?
Yeah, I keep blanking. I feel like I must have seen something that she was in, but I don't know, nothing comes to mind.
She's Misery. That was what sort of brought it to mind for us.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Actually, now that you mentioned that, that makes sense.
Yeah, I don't know anything else off the top of my head, but I've definitely seen Misery because it was in a recent episode. But beyond that, not a clue.
I was just going to say, I've just looked at the Letterboxd filmography, and the first thing that I immediately spot out of that is she had a voice role playing the Grand Witch in Scooby-Doo and the Goblin King.
So there you go, I've seen that. but I just didn't
check that on Letterboxd. Scooby-Doo had staying power, he don't dispute that.
Yeah. Very much the love and bacall of cartoon dogs. That dog.
Yeah. So, wrapping up, Graham, where can we find you and the stuff you do online?
Well, I'm the host of Pop Screen, the Geek Show's, the sister podcast really to this show, where every week we take a look at another film or TV show starring by or about a major music artist. I also regularly write for The Geek Show, and I'm currently working on an exhibition, a group exhibition up at Scarborough's Woodall Gallery, where I'll be doing a video piece, some sound art, and a load of other stuff that I don't know about yet, and I'm panicking.
Yeah, I saw your behind-the-scenes video on Instagram of how you made those songs, and it just sounds good in person, but making them in reality, not so much.
It's good to demystify artistic practice, I think.
Yeah. Clotilde, yourself?
I am a self-writer for Loud and Clear Reviews and The People's Movies, and I also write for The Independent and other websites. I'm not going to mention all of them because we'd be here for a long time. But I also talk about films a lot. So I also talk about films on The Chronicle as a co-host. And we're on like YouTube, Spotify, all of those, wherever you get your podcasts. And yeah, I'm on social media. It's at Films with Chloe on Twitter and on Letterboxd, and the person being Chloe on Instagram.
And Aiden.
Yeah, so the main place you can find me is on my Letterboxd under the username AidenF, where, like I say, I post like a lot of my film thoughts and reviews on there, really. And that's pretty much the main place you can find me. You can also find me on Twitter under the username DoppoAndDrummer. And apart from that, the Geek Show podcast as well. So I appear on this quite a bit, as well as...
And everything else in the NDA, because you're not allowed to say what you're working on.
Yes, top secret. You never know what I could... You could think I'm a secret spy, in all honesty. No one would tip out an eyelid. Yeah, I work in film and TV as well. And yeah, it's a fun world. It's an exhausting one too. But yeah. I love my career, so I can't have it any other way.
Absolutely. Best way to be. And until next time with Lauren Bacall, thank you very, very much for listening.